New Year! Woo! I made this video a few years ago with my friend James, who provides the incredible footage for the YouTube channel Journey to the Microcosmos. And in that video, you will get to meet my friend Jake the Tardigrade. And the reason I'm mentioning this is in the time since making Jake the Tardigrade, I have also turned Jake the Tardigrade into a print. How neat is that? Speaking of prints and things, I am offering some limited edition exclusive perks for the first time on my Patreon. If you join the $9 tier between now and January 22nd, you get one of these two cool stickers. This one is the actual brain size of a raccoon. Both of these stickers were designed by my friend Henning in Sweden, so thanks Henning. And this card I designed so it looks like a microscope slide. So it's like if you're looking from down and it says, hey there, and this is like backwards in case you were like looking up and you were like, oh, I'm from the other side. Anyway, if you join the $25 and up perk level, you'll get a really cool holographic brain scoop sticker and then a limited edition print of this size. So one of these or another one that's 4x6-ish. We'll just see what happens. So those are just some cool bonus ways that you can support the Brain Scoop in the new year. Also, we launched a Discord. So we already have over 500 people in our great Discord community. If you don't know what Discord is, it's basically like an internet forum, but in 2024. We have all different kinds of channels where we talk about our nerd interests and museums and taxidermy and nerd fashion and all kinds of fun things. So check us out on Discord. And also, that was it. I had nothing else. I just got really excited. More new content soon. I love you. Thank you. Goodbye. Enjoy the video. Ba-ba-ba-ba-da-ba.
Hi, James.
Hello. Hi.
It's so good to see you.
So good to see you too.
This is James Weiss. You may know him from the channel Journey to the Microcosmos. He collects samples of water from habitats large and small and near and far, from mosses to lakes and from his backyard to other countries.
So at some point I had like 500 different samples in my house.
What? He's on a quest to learn more about the unknown.
I searched for a group of microorganisms called protists.
James is about to take us on a tour of his minuscule worlds. But before we get there, I want to first focus on his focus. I mean, microscopes are everywhere today, but it feels impossible to imagine a time when they weren't. The first compound microscope dates back to around 430 years ago, but the technology wouldn't take hold for centuries. It was in 1665 that English scientist Robert Hooke captivated members of the Royal Society in London with vivid illustrations of the organisms he saw on his slides, including fleas, flies, snowflakes, and frozen pea? Presumably his, although we don't know, like there's not a notation or anything. Around that same time, Antony von Leeuwenhoek, a self-taught scientist, refined the craft of lens making and created a new type of microscope that could produce a clearer image at a higher magnification. This went beyond what even Robert Hooke could see, but it was expensive and time-consuming, and you kind of have to wonder that without a formal science background, maybe Leeuwenhoek's descriptions of the miraculous dancing creatures that only he could see kind of made him come off as a bit peculiar to certain members of the Royal Society. After all, it was only 10 years earlier that Robert Hooke had wooed them with his peacicle illustrations, so maybe their imaginations were stretched a little thin. I'm just saying. Leeuwenhoek died in 1723, so it would be almost a century and a half later in the 1860s that chemist Louis Pasteur demonstrated that diseases could be caused by the little wigglies found underneath those fancy lenses, and not just by the miasma, aka smelly air. And with that, microscopes took off throughout the mid to late 1800s as they increasingly became more powerful and more affordable. In Victorian-era Great Britain, users marveled at these new windows into otherwise invisible worlds. James talks about this too.
It's just mind-blowing. It's like going on a safari, you know? Like every time I sit in front of my microscope, I'm just, you know, it's just a whole different planet, and it's fascinating.
So many Victorians, without the scientific language to describe what they were seeing, came to the conclusion that they were looking directly into fairy lands. Because within every scrape of pond scum, they found seemingly infinite numbers of bewildering creatures. I mean, were these fairies? After all, microbes and pixies have a lot in common. They're both small, fantastic in appearance, profuse in number, invisible to the naked eye, and they have wonderful names, like, you know, Una versus E. coli. Basically one and the same. I mean, scholars had serious debates about this stuff. Fairy tale authors were using microscopic discoveries to bring more credibility to their fantasies, and meanwhile, scientists were borrowing fanciful language from authors and poets to explain the perplexing things they were seeing in their scopes, but they also didn't want to use folklore or superstitions to explain natural phenomena. This created tension by bringing into question the role that human imagination and wonder play in scientific observation. Lamenting this replacement of beliefs in magic lands with the reality of bacterial vats, author Sabine Baring-Gould wrote, "For untold ages, our ancestors had believed in a fairy world. In its place, a door has been opened, disclosing to our astonished eyes a whole bacterial world, living, making love, fighting. Scientifically, we have gained much. Imaginatively, we have lost a great deal." Well, Sabine Baring-Gould, I beg to differ, because what James is about to show me is an animal that for a long time I thought was just made up.
Wow. This is a tardigrade.
Wow.
Or a water bear.
I mean, honestly, can you blame me? Like, tardigrades are the wildest looking animals. They have these chubby bodies, eight legs with little hooky claws on them, basically just a sucker plunger face. I mean, they're so cute. How'd you get to be so cute? It's so weird. I love you, you cute weirdo. It's wild to think about mid-19th century science nerds geeking out about tardigrades too, but Jay Murray sure did. In 1905, he published Tardigrades from the Scottish Lochs, including descriptions of Loch Ness tardigrades. So if anyone has info on that ichthyosaur-looking weirdo, you know who to ask. Who's the Loch Ness monster? It's you! You're the Loch Ness monster! You didn't even know!
So what I do is, when I find tardigrades, I keep them alive in little humidity chambers. Like, when you say humidity chamber, it sounds fancy, but it's just Tupperware with a bit of wet tissue in the bottoms. So I name my water bears. So this is Alfred.
Tardigrades, aka water bears, aka moss piglets, can be found all over the world. Some tardigrades can endure extreme conditions and habitats, like in geysers and even from exposure to the vacuum of space, but mostly they love mosses and dirt and soil and wet environments like lakes.
I find them often and I love them so much. This one came from a park just next to my house. It was just a tube of pond sediment. I came home and Alfred was there. So Jake is one of my favorites. His name is Jake because of my favorite TV series, Adventure Time. So there's a magic dog there. I view Jake under polarized light. So this illumination technique just makes some of the inorganic substances shine like this. So can you see the belly? This is Jake's stomach, and it's just full of the things that it ate.
Yeah.
When it ate the algae,
wow,
poops rainbows.
So as much as James loves his tardigrades, they aren't the only thing that have captured his heart.
So I search for protist. That's my passion. That's like, I'm crazy about them.
So to know what a protist is, it helps to have some microbio fundamentals. All living things are made up of cells, and there are two kinds. Prokaryotic cells, which are always single-celled organisms, like bacteria, but it also includes this group called archaea, which are really primitive single-celled organisms. And there are eukaryotic cells, which can be single or multicellular. So organisms with eukaryotic cells include fungi, plants, animals, and protists. A whole weird group all of their own that don't really fall into any other category. like this diatom?
So this is a diatom. They're quite famous. There are like trillions of them on Earth, and they generate more oxygen than the rainforest every year.
What?
Yes.
Two-thirds of the oxygen on Earth comes from diatoms. There's just so many of them, hundreds of thousands of different species, and they're found in most every aquatic environment in the world. They fossilize really well, and they're valuable indicators of ecosystem health, so they create great records of our planet's changes over time. Their cell walls are made of silicate, which is glass. It protects them while they're alive and preserves them when they die. Diatoms are also one of those magical things that Victorians glommed onto. They illustrated them in exacting detail. And professional microscopists like J.D. Muller artfully and painstakingly arranged diatoms into orderly, mesmerizing designs. But the Victorian art of diatom arrangement was full of secrecy, and most of the techniques died with their creators. Today, British biologist Klaus Kemp is the only living person still practicing this art form. But aside from just diatoms, there's a lot of contemporary art inspired by the microscopic. In 2018, a touring exhibit from Sydney showcased the work of indigenous artists who created pieces inspired by microscope slides. From a slide of a blood cell clotting from a crocodile, artist Arcuria Rose Armstrong made this painting about the origin of the opal. Her family's story is that the opal was created during a storm when the colors of a rainbow were trapped in the rain on the scales of a dying crocodile. And I mean, James's videos and photographs are just another homage to this impossibly vast world of ours.
Spend time checking my microscope for 10 hours every day sometimes, and it makes me happy. That's everything I get from this.
All right, that does it for this episode of Art Lab. I just want to say thank you to our production partners over at the Described and Captioned Media Program. They create high-quality, accessible media for teachers and students with disabilities. If you want to know more, check out their website at dcmp.org. And thanks to our patrons for also supporting Art Lab. If you would like to support us, you can check us out on Patreon, and that would be awesome. We have a great little community over there. Art Lab nerds, it's very fun. Come join us. Oh my gosh, I just like ripped his leg off. I was so excited. This is my stress tardigrade. I got so excited. I can't handle my enthusiasm for our community. It's so good. I ripped a leg off a tardigrade for it. Anyway, yeah, thanks for watching. Like and subscribe and tell your friends.
It still has brains on it.